Okay, so I think we're live. How's it going? Can everybody see me okay? It says I'm live. The new system is horrible compared to the old one. It literally just thinks as it, you got to click start and then it has a delay before it tells me it's live. So, and when I've been re-uploading these shows, I've had to trim off the first 8 seconds off everyone. So that's what's going on. How are you guys this week? I am early, right? It is 2:45. Why are we early? Well, I have a lot to talk about, but something exciting today, something I'm excited about. So maybe if you're excited about it too, it might work out. Let's see. Okay. So, there's already 100 of you. I appreciate you guys hanging out with me already on Friday. And, so I figure we'll talk about a few things. The first thing I want to talk about is something that's a little business oriented. What happened was Teespring, who does the shirts, you know, every YouTube channel now, if you look underneath them, they have those shirts for sale through Teespring. I have them as well. Teespring reached out to me and gave me an offer. So I'm going to give the offer to you guys. I've done sales, when I do the live shows, I've done sales all the time, but this is a 10% offer. There's a coupon code in the description. The only reason I'm mentioning it is it's not me this time. Teespring, believe it or not, the manufacturer contacted me and said, hey, we want to promote your shirts. They're going to eat the 10%. So they said, hey, I offer 10% off to your viewers. Whatever they buy between Friday, which is today, and Monday, they'll reimburse that. So they're going to give you 10% off, and then they'll reimburse that 10% back to me later, where before I was kind of just cutting into my margin. I get to keep the margin. So if you're thinking about getting some merch and you want a discount code, you get that. Plus, you get to know that more of the money goes towards the channel and less towards their pocket. So that was nice of them to do that. That was pretty cool. They did that basically because we've sold a lot of shirts and they wanted to do something, I guess, to promote it and help. So I thought that was cool. So there you go. Coupon code down below. I think it's like ENDOFSUMR. And let you know, this is the first time where the discount isn't coming on my side. So that's kind of nice. A little nice reprieve. Normally, just so you guys know, normally when we do these codes, they work. In fact, usually sell twice as many shirts as I normally do, but because of the discount codes, I'm net about the same. So I get twice as many shirts out there, which I think is great, but you take it, you know, you take a hit on the income side of it, but at least you get the promotion out there. This time, whatever you guys do, you save money and I still get to keep some of the cash, which is nice. And then Matt Wells says, Phil, just letting you know that you missed my super chat last week. Matt, let me find it. Let's see. Matt Wells, there you are, buddy. Says, hey, Phil, 15 years of playing, finally bought a Fuzz Kingmaker by Source Audio. Being a Fuzz rookie, is Fuzz and OD an either or can they be recommended on how to run them together into a DSL-40C? Oh, great question. And great amp. If you know, talking about a perfect amp. That Fuzz pedal, if it was me and I had that Fuzz pedal and that amp, which I've had the DSL-40C, if I was running it, I'd run that amp low gain, right? Don't saturate that amp up. Just get that amp to the closest to that plexi kind of early 80s, late 70s British rock kind of gain. And then what I would do is then kick that fuzz pedal in front of it and experiment with those sounds. I think a fuzz pedal in front of a low gain British amplifier has just this tremendously powerful tone, especially for soloing. You'll notice that hang on a note, just kind of bend a note and hold it. It's like a sustaining pedal. It's like just like that note will just hang around for an hour. Plus, keep in mind on the clean channel on that amp, run that amp a little hard and put that fuzz pedal in there, man. That's how you get that Hendrix thing going. Hendrix with a fuzz into a cranked Marshall. That's a great tone. So that's what you could do. So no, it's not an either or. You can use your overdrive and your fuzz pedals in conjunction together as well, is how I usually do it. I usually run fuzz. If I'm running fuzz, most of the time for me, if I'm running it, I'm running it into either overdrive pedal or into an amp that's slightly overdriven. To me, a fuzz pedal into a clean amp is very like, that's when you really get the fuzz. Like I think a Weezer, there's a ton of bands where it's like a Muse, that really fuzzy kind of over the top sound. Very cool, but you know, not always the sound you're going for. So mixed with overdrive, it's just a beautiful addition to your overdrive. It's a way to get something to sound a little better. So now, if you guys noticed that we're probably a little early, that's why there's 270 of you. I really appreciate that. That's a pretty good turnout for being this early. Why are we early? Well, if you're YouTube junkies like I am and you watch a lot of YouTube, you probably noticed that there's about 300 or 400, I was thinking maybe 450 videos about the Sweetwater world record setting pedal board. I'm just kidding. I know there's a lot. Here's how I know. There was 34 pedal boards in that thing, right? 36 pedal boards, something like that. And they sent most amount to YouTubers and to guitar magazines to help promote this event. Well, obviously I got one, and I wanted to try something I've been thinking about doing. We've talked about it on the live shows many times, which is, what happens if at the live show, at the end of the live show, I screen a video for you guys? So I'm going to do that. I'm going to do something I've never done before, which is release the video after the live show today, so you'll get to see it. They sent me a pedal board, and I unboxed it, and it's a... you know what? It was one of my favorite videos. It was weird. I was one of those videos that I just didn't see coming the way it is. So I thought I'd share about that and help promote Sweetwater. And then talk about this. This is kind of fun. There's something emotionally cool about this event for me. Here's what's cool about it. Sweetwater is one of the... I say few because I want to be fair, because in case somebody slips my mind. But really, when I think of companies, I think of one, and it's Sweetwater. But to be fair, we'll say few. Even though it's one. Sweetwater is the only company I've ever done a video that was, let's say, negative, or I critiqued them in a, you know, I didn't say, hey, this is the greatest thing ever. That did a couple things. One, reached out to me immediately and said, okay, you know, we respect what you say, we respect what you do, which was crazy. It's nice of them to say that. And that's not who we are. What can we do to make this better? And not only did that, but then, as you guys remember, then they said, how can we make this experience better for others? Which I gave them some opinions, and they put all those opinions in fruition. If you guys remember when I did the critique of my infamous Telecaster that I bought from them that I didn't enjoy, that I sent back, one of my complaints was that I thought, you know, not only did it not hold up to what I thought it should be, I was confused on what they had even done to it in the first place. And from that video, as you guys may know, some of you may know this, some of you may not, Sweetwater decided, based on that video and the conversation after that video with me, that they were going to revise the 55-point inspection and now publish it. So it's the first time in Sweetwater's history it's been published. It's on my website as well. If you ever want to download it, I have a downloadable checklist, which Sweetwater said was totally okay with them, that if you go, you can download the checklist of... So if you buy a guitar from Sweetwater... and they told me, so you know, this is why the story is interesting. They told me point blank on the phone. They said, you know, part of our concern about giving the customers the actual 55-point inspection was, what if the customer goes through and checks each box and goes, okay, well, this isn't what, you know, isn't right, and we're going to get a lot of pushback. And my advice to them was, you either do it or don't. You know what I mean? You're going to hold to your own standard or you're not. And that was my opinion. And they got back to me and said, you're absolutely right. Chuck Sarek, who's the owner of Sweetwater, watched your video in his office. And he said, you know, Phil got it right with the, we got to make this better. Now, why am I telling you this story? Because unlike some people didn't agree with it, some people did, but most YouTubers that I know, most of the channels I know, they knew what I really had done in that video. I'd pretty much screwed any chances of ever working with the largest music store in the world. You know, everybody thinks I did it for clicks. Well, you don't realize I'm literally just put myself in a position to where the largest music store in the world would pretty much be pissed off at me. And it's one of those moments in my life where I can say on YouTube, it worked out. It worked out great. I gave an opinion. It was an honest opinion. It wasn't a positive thing to have to hear. They heard it. They made changes. And the reason why I'm telling you that story now is I was one of the YouTubers that was included in when they mailed out the pedal boards and they're interacting with this event. And that is important to me because although they said all these things to me and they took all these changes, I never really knew deep down if we had a positive relationship. You know what I mean? I didn't know if it was like, okay, they said these nice things to me. They made some changes, but was it because, you know, they really, really do respect and want to work with my channel? Or is it just because, you know, they didn't want the grief of hearing my audience complain. And I really feel like it's the most connected I felt. So I want to give them the accolade, because not because they're one of the companies that have done this. They're the only one. I have 600 videos. And although most of my videos, I'd say 98%, 99% are positive, you know, the ones that are not the most positive reviews, it's great to hear a company basically say, yeah, we want to hear not a negative opinion, but we want to hear what you really think. And thank you for not sugarcoating it, or thank you for at least not hiding, you know, being afraid. So there you go. I just like to share you. Paul Fuchs says, honestly, always wins out. Paul, I don't agree. I wish it was always that way. I feel like a lot of times honesty really kicks you in the nuts. But you know, but doesn't mean you have to do it. It's just nice when it does win out, because then it really charges the batteries to go, I'm going to keep going with that mentality of just, you know, hey, I'll try to be as transparent as possible with this stuff. So there you go. That's what's going on. So look for that video today. Let me know what you guys think when you see that video. What else do we have going on? I know we got a lot of questions, and we have some topics this week, because it was a crazy week in the gear world. And let me kind of pull up the top chats. Let's see what's going on there, and I'll make sure I get to the non-top chat questions. I always try to do the one for one. Let's see. Griselda says, any recommendations on a bass wah? I just bought a bass wah at Sam Ash. Last Sunday. That's pretty recent. Last Sunday, I went and saw my guitar teacher play at the Rhythm Room. His name's Matt Van Dahl, the Matt Van Dahl Band. Fantastic band. And when I was there, I was on that side of town, so I went to Sam Ash, and I saw the mini bass wah by Dunlop. And I was told it was a good wah for guitar. I did not enjoy it for the guitar. I plugged it in. I was not having fun. But especially since you're supporting the channel by doing the top chat, I don't have a problem knocking out a quick little video and throwing it on Instagram, or do a quick video of the bass wah on a bass and tell you what I think. But aside from that, what I will tell you is I use wah on my bass all the time, but I usually use a guitar wah. I've been using a guitar wah forever. When I used to take bass lessons, I took bass lessons from an amazing bass player here in Arizona named Ray Riendo. And at that time, Ray was playing with a guitar wah on his bass. So I just use a Crybaby wah on my bass. So that's what I use, is a Crybaby wah. And if you want to know what Crybaby I use, I use the Clyde McCoy by Dunlop. I've switched here and there, but that one I keep going back to. So, and I think it's because I know what the main difference between a bass wah and a regular guitar wah is. The bass wah is going to have a lower frequency sweep, and a lot of times it'll probably let some low end signal through it. So you, because a lot of times the problem with electric guitar effects using on the bass, especially a wah, is that when you click on it, all the low end is going to get scooped out, and the band's going to lose that low end. But to me, if you're using a wah on a bass guitar, you're showing off. It's show off time, right? You're not probably holding down the band at that point, I wouldn't think, but I could be wrong. I'm going to do one more top chat, and then I'll switch screens back over to some non-top chats. Everybody else on the top chat, I promise you're penned, you're safe. Dale says, Superchamp X2 head in a 112 cabinet. I'm a home player, just want something better sounding than a practice amp. Should I look at something else? You know what? I love that amp. I think you can't go wrong. My only recommendations on that amp, if you're going to go that route, is that for me, and it has no... No, I have no affiliate program set up with Tolman. And the reason I say that is because, I have affiliate links, just not with Tolman. To me, if I was going to do that rig for $200 for the 112 Fender cabinet, I would get the Superchamp head and that Harley Benton 212 cabinet. That seems like, I love that cabinet more than the 112. It will sound a little bigger and fuller. It won't take up much more space. Just something to think about. The reason why I think that's interesting, I brought that up because it's about the same price, just a little bit more. Somebody emailed me and said that the Harley Benton 212 cabinets with vintage 30s, they raised them $30. I think I went on their website and I saw that. I would usually call that out as some BS, as, hey, you know, the video, because that video went viral on this channel, and that drove a lot of sales for them. Tolman was very upfront about that they sold a lot of cabinets off that video. But I know this, they sold out of cabinets. So I'm trying to give them a pass, and here's why. They sold out of cabinets, and what cabinets came in is a new reorder, and I noticed the price went up. So I could say they raised the price because the the video sold a lot of cabinets. I could also say they raised the price because the second batch or this new order went up. I don't know. I could reach out and ask them. Maybe I should do that. They seem pretty transparent about what they're up to. They're a big company. They don't seem to be afraid of, you know, some noise. But normally I would recommend instead of the 112 cabinet that goes with it, unless you just go in for the aesthetics, I would go with like even the Fender Hot Rod Deluxe 112. Just a bigger cabinet makes that amp sound a lot fuller on the clean. And even if you want to turn down, if you're trying to be quiet, turn down the bigger cabinet sounds fuller at low volumes. So something like that, whether it's a 212 or just an oversized 112, just something to think about on that. And that amp especially, I've played that amp 1,000 different ways because I really, really, really like that amp. Let's see. What else you guys got? James Wickman says more free candy. Yeah, see, that's another thing in the video. You guys know I'm not a big fan of the candy at Sweetwater. Maybe I changed my mind. Maybe there's something in the video different now, because there was definitely something different. Let's see. Orange Car Bad says get your degree at Sweetwater in Sweetwater Sales Engineering. Sally Mae is proud to proud participant. I don't know if I get the joke. Is that because I know they call them sales engineers? I didn't know. Is that like some kind of training? Again, I can't tell. You could be joking. I don't pick up on the joke too fast. I'm pretty sarcastic by nature, but it's hard to read sarcasm. But I don't know. Do they have like it says Sally Mae is a proud participant. You know, McDonald's has a school, so I don't know why Sweetwater couldn't have a school. The Sweetwater School of Sales Engineering. Let me tell you this. If Sweetwater had a school of sales engineering like McDonald's does, I would gladly take that training if they would give it to me. One thing I've learned is that, you know, every time I see a chance, like I've took basic luthery courses in the last 2 years, just gone to one, right? Because there was like one for like $50. So I just went. I had a blast and I learned a couple things, and that's the thing about that stuff. You never know, you know, sometimes you think you got it all figured out, and then, somebody figures it out faster than you or better than you or quicker, or just sees it from a different angle. It's really fun. And I pretty much can't be bored with anything guitar. Let's see. What else do we got? Let's jump around. I want to do one more. Bill says they need a candy quality checklist. Dale. Okay, so Dale's, thanks, Dale. Dale's definitely a longtime viewer, man. Dale's been since the beginning of the channel. He says, I discovered a free candy with Sweetwater orders or hit or miss. Well, that was the thing when I did the video. I did the video to be tongue-in-cheek, to be kind of funny. I was making fun of the Sweetwater candy, but mostly I was just pointing out that I'm not a big fan of hard candy and I don't like it. And, what's funny about that was I requested to have no candy, which is what Sweetwater will do for your orders. But what I learned since then is that you can request. You know who told me? Dave Freeman from Freeman Amps told me, hey, you know, you can request the candy. And I'm like, what? It's hit or miss. Sometimes they do it and sometimes they don't. But if you were so Dale, if you like a certain type of candy, you can request that with your sales engineer. This is definitely going to sound like some kind of Sweetwater sales thing, but we are talking about the thing they have to give away. So you know, you can request the type of candy. It's got to be within their realm of the candies, right? So you could say, hey, just give me Fireballs or just give me this. I'm pretty sure Brian Stewart also told me that he gets only Fireballs or something like that. I'm sure Brian will correct me if I'm wrong. But so that's what I do now is I changed it from no candy to this kind of candy. And what I notice is that they're slanted on that kind of candy. And of course, like any smart person, I picked one of the candies as my candy my kids like. If you can, here's what Sweetwater figured out that's smart. If you can figure out how to get your kids excited about you getting a piece of gear because they know candy's coming, that's smart. So, all right. Let's see. Okay, a couple of you guys are chatting back and forth. While you guys do that, I will jump over to the pinned questions, or what we call the top chats. Maybe if that screen. Oh, there it is. All right, where do we leave off? We left off with 123 Jim Thomas just said thank you and did a tap chat. Thank you, buddy. I appreciate that. Brian says LTD quality. Looking at a thin line six, wanting an ASP SST coupe, but won't ever come out. Your thoughts on the LTD and Epi, please. Sure, Epiphone LTD to me are perfect that you mentioned both those brands, because they're both, to me, in the same realm of guitars. And the idea, when I think LTD and Epiphone, I think of two things, which is why it's interesting. One, I think of guitars that are way better than their price points. These are guitars that when I see somebody on stage playing an LTD or an Epiphone, I think, yeah, that's somebody who figured it out. They know they got the right guitar quality-wise, and they're on short money. So, yes. So if somebody says, hey, LTD Epiphone, great value, good guitars, what do you think? Yes. That's one. On the second side, both Epiphone and LTD can put out some really big turd guitars too. And they tend to, those crappier guitars tend to land in the lower price points. But what I've learned from both those brands is that from working on them is that in the lower price points, they will make good guitars. They're just, you need to get your hands on it. So my point to this is I would love to say something so blanket statement easy as, you know, $500 and up, they're good, just go with them. But what I will tell you is, let's say about $500 and up on both Epiphone and LTD, I will say you have a 90% success rate. That's how I feel. You know, 9 out of 10 guitars that if you were to try 9 of the 10 models of the same guitar, you would be happy with nine of them, you know. And at under $500, I think that changes to more to like a 60-40. In other words, 6 out of 10 you'd be happy with. So it just needs to mean, just means you either have to A, get your hands on it first, or B, do some research before you do the purchase online, or be aware that you might have to do a change out on a guitar. So that happens. So, and the reason why I say that, so you know, is one of the problems with us now in the world where we have to buy online is mentally be prepared. That's what I'm trying to convey to you guys. When I talk about, you know, checking out a guitar versus online and be prepared for the guitar to have problems, the reason why I tell you that is I've learned this little secret with me emotionally, and I'm sure a lot of people are like me, because I'm hoping or I'm thinking that if you're watching a guy like me talk on YouTube, you probably are like me in the idea that we like guitars a lot. And so one of the things I do that's I've learned to stop, right? Stop doing is I like to when I order something online and I get it, I used to be like, okay, it's getting here Thursday. And then I get on Thursday and I'm very excited. And if it's not right, you're very bummed. You're thinking about all the time lost. Now I mentally try to prepare for, basically, when it gets here, be prepared to that if you have to send it and get another one changed out, put that in your timeline, because a lot of times you'll just quit. You'll go, this is so that's just the world we live in now. But I think if you do your research right, you shouldn't have to do that. And as you guys know from watching my videos, you can get a bad guitar on the high end and the low end. It doesn't matter. And you can get a good guitar at any price point, too. Just do a little bit more research. The High Advisor says, have you ever replaced a humbucker with a TV Jones Filtertrone in a Tele or a Strat? Not in a Tele or a Strat. I have had to, where I've replaced the most Filtertrones and humbucker space guitars, where I've done a dozen at least of the Gretsch Electromatic series, especially the older ones that had the squared off, you know, the fakey looking Filtertrones where it was just a metal cover stuck on a regular basic humbucker. And so you'd have to pull those out of the guitars and then do some kind of movements and adjust to put the smaller, you'd have to buy an adapter plate, put that on there and put the Filtertrones in there. So so it can be done. On a Strat or Tele, I've never done it on a Strat. On a Tele, I've put a Filtertrone in the neck, but never in the bridge. And on the neck, it was pretty straightforward. I have a Filtertrone TV Jones style template. I'm pretty sure you can pick one up online pretty cheap nowadays. I mean, back in the day when you back in the day was 10 years ago, 10, 15 years ago, 15 years ago, you used to get templates. You either made them or you got them from your buddies and then you had them and you kept them. They were like gold. Now you can go online and get a template to anything for dirt cheap, or just print it off the internet and stick it onto a piece of wood or whatever, and then router it. I use plastic, but so just get the template and you can put it in the Tele. The Strat or Tele, the only thing you have to worry about is the Filtertrone is the TV Jones Filtertrone is not as wide as tall. I don't know how you. I guess we'll say it's wide because we'll say length is the side to side and width is the is the north and south, in other words, from the bridge to the neck. The width is wider than a single coil, obviously, but not as wide as a humbucker, but it doesn't matter. You still need almost the same amount of space underneath the hood, in other words. So for a Tele and a Strat, your pick guard is not going to be the problem. You can route that, but you got to make sure that you have the right spacing. Most Telecasters you come across are going to have a humbucker route out at the neck, so you're fine. Most Telecasters will not have a humbucker routing at the bridge, so you will have to deal with that. Strat-wise, it's going to be 50-50. Most Strats are either humbucker single-single routed or humbucker single-humbucker routed. Mostly, that's the two routing configurations you're going to see with most Strats and aftermarket Strats. Very few Strats are single-single-single other than vintage-style guitars. So just do some research. But the important part, I think, to your question is, have I ever done it? Yes. Can it be done? Absolutely. Is it hard? No. On a project scale of routering and doing stuff, I think... Yes, it can be done. The only way I would not recommend the hobbyist to do that project is if you're pulling out some kind of $3,000 guitar. Don't do that. Practice on something affordable. Let's see. What else? Adam Harper says, I want a second Strat. How many Strats is too many Strats? Well, I think that's a weird question because this is the old question of how many guitars do you need and how many is too many guitars? And I've said this over and over again. I'll say it again. Guitars are a luxury item. You don't need any. So it's up to everybody to decide what they want. A lot of people like to push their own, like, hey, you know, I only have 6 guitars, so you have 10. That's ridiculous. I don't know. Everybody has a ridiculous number. Somebody will have 1 and say 5 is ridiculous. Somebody will have 50 and say 100 is ridiculous. How many Strats? I don't know. What I will tell you is this. I think if I wasn't a collector, collecting guitars as well, I think I would pretty much have 1 style of guitar and it'd be a Strat. And I'd probably have 3 or 4 total guitars in my entire collection if I was using them for just the practical purpose of using guitars. Which is different than I think, and the reason why I'm saying that is that different than what I think you guys think I would say. I think you guys would think if I could only have 5 guitars, not as a collector, but as a musician to perform with, to play with, to use, you think I would pick like a Les Paul, a Strat, a Gretsch. No, it would be basically 5 different Strats. I would pick 1 guitar and I'd have 5 different versions of it. That's because I think that's the most logical thing you can do if you're playing all the time is keep a guitar that you're used to playing all the time. If you notice a lot of guitar players, they'll play the same type of guitars a lot because you get used to knowing where stuff is. You know, with me, some of my biggest problems when I'm doing demos on videos, which people don't understand. Side note, a lot of people sometimes on a video go, man, your playing's really improved. And then 2 videos later, like they don't, you know, this guy sucks. And then a couple of years, wow, you're really getting good. You realize I'm not a virtuoso, so what happens is when I have to demo a guitar that I'm not familiar with, or I'm trying a guitar I'm not familiar with, you're kind of like fumbling around. You know what I mean? Sometimes I'm like, you know, to me, sometimes I'm just used to on my guitars that I like to play, the 12 frets, like right here, and all of a sudden it's down here or up here, and it really messes you up. It really messes me up. It's like, so some players have no problem with that, but me, if you give me a Strat, I could play it in the dark. If you give me another style of guitar, I need to pay attention to what I'm doing because I haven't been playing it long enough. So there you go. What else do we got? Hold on. There is... You guys are chatting amongst yourself as well. So this is a good time to bring up a subject. This week, big news. Cites. You guys have probably seen this too. Cites has made some changes. And the changes are interesting because there's some verbiage in the new changes that did some research on and I'm still a little confused by. So let me tell you what the changes are. So they've made an amendment, I'm just losing it today, to the Cites regulations, and it's going to be that musical instruments will be basically exempt as finished products. So in other words, we'll be able to ship them. You can ship guitars with rosewood. Brazilian rosewood does not count. That's a separate Cites agreement. So do not confuse Brazilian rosewood with the secondary Cites problem, which is rosewood. Okay, so we're just talking about rosewood, Indian rosewood, Madagascar, whatever rosewood you're talking about, wherever it comes from. So basically what's happening is, if you have a guitar, we no longer need paperwork, Cites paperwork, to ship a guitar to like England or from England to, you know, Australia or Japan. You could already travel with them before, so that didn't change. But here's where it's a little tricky. It's basically, so guys like us, buyers of guitars, we're definitely set. So if you have a guitar and you want to sell it on Reverb, you don't have to worry about where it goes. You don't need paperwork anymore. Good for you, right? builders. Well, people who import guitars in the U.S., so people like Squire or Epiphone or, you know, a plethora of import brands, Dean, you name it, they can import guitars now, finished goods, guitars and guitar parts, with Rosewood and no longer need Cites paperwork. So that's a good thing. But where it was interesting in the verbiage is it says that basically finished goods, it's basically talking about finished goods. This is an issue because, believe it or not, there's a couple industries in the United States that have talked about this where it's cheaper for them and better for them to bring in finished goods than raw materials. And the way this new kind of Cites thing is written, it kind of implies that again. So in other words, it looks like it's going to be cheaper and easier for Fender to import a Chinese, well, not Chinese, I don't want to pick on that, but import a guitar with Rosewood as a guitar, finished product, than it is to import the Rosewood itself. Now, is that a big deal? No. And do I think it's going to cause a problem? No. But what I'm saying is, while we are should be happy that we can now ship and buy and sell Rosewood guitars with no issue, as long as they're not Brazilian, and it should take some of the issues away from the import guitars, I think we might see the high-end U.S. manufacturers like Kiesel that are doing the guitars where they're offering ebony as the main guitar, as the wood instead of a rosewood. I think that will continue to stay that way because I don't see a benefit to them. I think it looks like the law is the same. So in other words, rosewood is, if you were importing rosewood last month in the U.S. raw to build guitars, it looks like nothing has changed for you. And so the reason I mention that is because that's part of that conversation, which is, you know, it's a problem, especially in the United States. And if you're watching this from other countries, every country is the same when it comes to this issue in Europe and stuff. It has the same issues, which is it feels like there's always a hindrance to build in your country. So I'm not saying that's what it is, but that's the way I'm interpreting it. And when I'm looking online and trying to figure out all the angles I'm seeing, it looks like I think I'm right on this one. It seems like they've relaxed it a lot, and I'm glad. But that one little catch, I think, means that for small builders, it doesn't mean it's going to stop them. It just means it's no improvement for them. Big Ideas 100 says, will Peo Ferro still be used? Peo Ferro is not on the list. So the wood is like every kind of rosewood, Babinga was on the list, and I think Purple Heart's on the list, because I think they're all part of the that species or whatever it is. But no, like Purple Heart and Chechen, no, those were off the list. That's why they were using them. So there you go. So I'm curious what your thoughts. So I thought I'd talk about that. Big improvement. We're excited. But I got a feeling that if you were worried about how it's going to affect the U.S. manufacturing, it doesn't look like it's helping them. It just helps everything else. Which is an overall help, but not all. Showman Blues. Hey, Showman. What's up? Again, another longtime viewer says, Phil, I hear mixed reports on Kiesel quality and customer service. Do you have any experience or opinions? I hear the same thing, buddy. Kiesel is a brand that it's like I can't get warm water from it. What I mean by that is everyone I know is either hot or cold. They either love Kiesel and they're telling me how dumb I am for missing out on the amazing Kiesel party of awesomeness, or they're telling me, in fact, every time I even talk about ordering one, that's why I hate talking about ordering. That's why I stopped talking about it, because every time I would do it, I would get emails and it would be like, Phil, when you get your Kiesel, your life is going to change. And I'm like, whoa. And the next email was like, Phil, I ordered two and they're crap. Stay away. And I was like, wow. So yeah, hot or cold. It's a brand that seems to run hot or cold. And sometimes I wonder if that's Jeff Kiesel. In other words, what I mean by that is he has an intense personality, and having an intense personality, I understand that. I seem to either piss people off or they tend to like it. So I understand that. So I wonder sometimes if it's the reaction isn't to the guitars, but it's to him. So that could be a part of it too. I'm okay with that, you know. So I'm assuming you guys are funny. I'm reading the comments. Anyway, so yeah, so that I've heard the same reports. See, Pat says loves my Kiesel. Overall, I think overall people like Kiesels. So, I mean, the ones I picked up at NAMM, I picked up at two NAMM shows now, I picked up Kiesels, and both times I was very happy with what I picked up. The reason I don't own a Kiesel is a reason why I think a lot of you, I fall in a very interesting bracket of non-Kiesel owners, which is the bracket some of you guys may relate to. So if you do, let me know in the comments. I like to hear when I have other people out there with my same afflictions. I go on their website, I build out a guitar, and then I quit. I've almost built out a Kiesel 20 times now on their website. I start, I go through the things, I get it to where I want, and then I look at the price tag and I go, that's too much, I don't want to pay that. And then I go back and I make some adjustments and I go, do I really want that? And then I start thinking about like, well, and it's going to take 3 or 4 months before I get it. And then I just stop every time. It's like I'm looking for the right excuse to pull that trigger, to finally do it. So, but I know the dumbest thing is a lot of times I think, okay, well, I got to review it too. And I definitely want to, you know, document that experience. And then I think, God, that's going to take 3-4 months. And then I'm like, 3-4 months, that's going to be this time of year and I'll have to deal with this. So it's weird. Mellow Yo says, Jeff Kiesel reminds me of a used car salesman. You know, he doesn't spark me that way. First of all, here's the thing about Jeff Kiesel. Like him or hate him, he is part of the amazing rebranding of Kiesel. I really pride myself because being in this industry and working and paying attention and being part of the gear community, I really call it right a lot. And I'm not saying that for egotistical purposes. I'm trying to explain why this has value when I got it wrong. Carbon rebranding, when the rebrand happened to Kiesel, I basically had nothing positive to say. I was like, it won't work. It seems silly. And I actually said somewhere, probably there's a video out there of me saying this. I said long ago when it happened, I said, Carbon rebranded Kiesel is a sign how bad the company's doing and it's probably not going to get better. And then bam, nope, they're 1,000 times better now. That company is probably one of the most healthy guitar companies in the industry with a backlog of guitars. Again, whether you like them or hate them, I don't care what your personal opinions of Jeff or Kiesel is. The company is doing well. You can, in this industry, just like any industry, I can walk around, you could go to the NAMM show, you can go into a factory, you can tell if a company's healthy or if it's dying. Kiesel is a healthy company. So, like, I don't have any reservations about, you know, putting a deposit down on the guitar and not worrying about the guitar being built. They're killing it. My biggest problem with them is the opposite. They're doing so well. Sometimes I feel like, man, it's just going to take so long. Chris Goodwin says, "Hey Phil, where's that gorgeous Warwick of yours?" It's in the gig bag right now. I wasn't playing bass this morning. I'm reading because you guys get so funny. Let's see. Oh, Brian said, his Kiesel was nice and he felt like he got what he paid for. Yeah. Overall, most people like their Kiesels. What's great is the one thing, like I said, when I talk about the transformation of Carbon to Kiesel, it's not only that I feel like the quality improved, although Carbons are good. But man, what he did, the most impressive thing he did, besides bring up the prices and the quality and the persona, the resale value on Kiesels is crazy good compared to what Carbons are. Carbons used to be, when I used to play everybody's Carbon. Every friend I had at one point had a Carbon, and you would play it and you go, man, this is amazing. And you'd be like, how much? And they'd be like, $1,000. And you'd be like, that's crazy. And then you go online, $200 used. I was like, wow. I mean, the resale value on a Carbon was about as bad as it could get. But now when I look at Kiesels, I thought about some of you guys have suggested, why don't you just buy a used Kiesel? And the reason I won't is because every time I find a used Kiesel, they're almost asking what they are new. And I think, oh, they'll never get it. And I keep looking and no, it either goes for that or it sits, but either way they don't, you know, so. MJ said, hey, longtime viewer, just saying thanks. I appreciate that. Okay, so what else do we got? Hold on, make sure I don't have a pin question because sometimes I don't. On the pin ones now. Oh, I do. See? I got to pay attention. Jeff Parker says, just thanks for all you do. Thank you, buddy. Wow, $20. That's impressive. It's, thank you so much. Just bought my first kit guitar to build. 3 actually, progressively harder. Done a lot of tricking out guitars from your vids. Going to build from new kits, then from scratch. Jeff, I would love it, if you send me pictures to the askknowyourgear@gmail.com. I love to see the before and after pictures or just how you're doing. That stuff is always cool. I always get interested, and it's for a ton of reasons. It's like Etsy kind of thing. You just get to see ideas and see what people are doing, and it's just really cool. So thank you. Thank you not only for the top chat, but thank you for letting me know the videos were helpful for you too. And like I said, I'd like to see what you're doing. The Lawrence Stoll said, just received an old Westone Spectrum DX today. Man, Westone guitars were a big deal in where I lived. I grew up as a kid in Tucson for the most, and in Tucson, most of the stores carried not the name brands. So you had one store that would carry like Ibanez, and one store carried Fender, two stores carried Fender, one store carried Gibson and Fender, and one store carried Ibanez. And I know that's funny because some of you guys are going to laugh, you know, like, oh, Ibanez, Fender, Gibson, but seriously, and that's, I mean, in the 90s, this is the 90s, by the way, in the 90s, that was the brands. The brands we had access to were Series 10, Hondo, Westone, Aria Pro, BC Rich Import. What else? I mean, it was all these brands. And the Westone guitars were the premium of the no-name brands. GTX, do you guys remember GTX? That was actually Applause, which was Ovation, was electric guitars. If you Google GTX guitars, you're gonna see some 80s shredder-looking guitars and stuff, crackle finishes. Westone had crackle finishes too. So it's funny, Lawrence, that you said that, just because, like I said, Westone was a brand when I was a kid. Like, that, believe it or not, that was a brand, that was a no-name brand, but I couldn't afford it. That was the premium brand of brands that most people didn't know. JB Player was another one. Like I said, it was just that way back in the day. You just had a lot of brands no one ever heard of. Joe McKinney says, updated thoughts on the JJ Jr. Replace the PT20 or the Runt? I replaced my PT20. It's gone. I sold the PT20. I definitely kept the JJ. So Joe, that's the easy part. And the reason why, and I said it in that video when I did, so I didn't include this in a video because I wasn't sure yet. I wish now, going back, it's one of those things, when I do my year summation video at the end of this year, I'll talk about it. In the video of me doing the Freeman JJ Jr. and the PT20, what wasn't explained in the video, because I wasn't sure at that moment, was that wasn't just me shooting out those amps. That was one of those amps were going to go. Which one? And it ended up being the Runt. And the logic being the Runt, I definitely like the JJ's distortion better than the Runt. I it's not because it's more distorted. I just think it's more, I don't know, more a Friedman kind of, I don't know. I just like it. I don't even know how to explain it. I just like it. In fact, more like the PT20, but less like the Runt. Very great. But it has a clean channel. The clean channel on the Runt, I thought, was slightly better than the JJ Jr. But it was overall the JJ won. And so I ended up keeping the JJ. I sold the PT20. I still had the Freeman PT20. Or sorry, sold the Runt 20. Sorry, didn't mean to confuse you, Joe. So the Runt 20 is gone. I sold that. The JJ is what I use now. And I have behind me, that's the PT20. In fact, I can probably, if I can shift around maybe somewhere. Oh, I can't. Oh, there it is. Down there, that's the JJ. So I still have the JJ. And so what's going to happen is the JJ or the PT will eventually go. But not anytime soon. I like them both. I'm still playing them both. I have no need to, you know, shuck off one of them right now. Other than the whole, you know, do I need two Friedman amps that are kind of the same? I'm actually leaning towards the JJ over the Runt, but I don't know. Like I said, I don't plan to get rid of either one of them. Definitely not this year. Whatever happens will happen next year. And it will be just because of maybe just redundancy of amps. So I still in the, and so yeah, still loving it, even past the honeymoon mode. Okay, hold on a second as we go. So I'm reading. When I do the non, that's the thing about the top chat questions. They're just so, they're big. They kind of print them big. So I have to kind of scroll through and look for you guys on the other questions. Okay. I love this. Beast Rich 581 says, Phil also walked barefoot in the snow. By the way, I was in the desert, so no snow here. Both ways to his elementary school, and he killed a bear with his trapper keeper. The only thing that's funny about that whole thing is I had to read it, was the trapper keeper. Those of us who had trapper keepers have had the experience, if you're a parent, which I am, the first time that you realize, like, that's not a thing. Like, I remember the first time you went to the store and you're like, hey, you want a trapper keeper? And that's not a thing. So, yeah, that really dates you in the trapper keeper. You know, trapper keeper was such a big deal Such a big deal. So yeah, not barefoot in the snow, and definitely can't walk barefoot in the heat here. Let's see. Okay, hold on. We got what else? Oh, Chris, some of you guys know what I'm talking about because you're talking about guitar stores in Tucson. Guitars Etc. is now closed. They are. Rainbows always have carried a great gear in Tucson. Yeah, Chris, here's a great Rainbow story that they probably won't like now hearing, but it's what happens. It's a life lesson for everybody, including me. So in down in Tucson, Arizona, the most prestigious, nicest store was Rainbow. When I was a kid, I know it's like an old story, but in the 90s, when I was buying, you know, in the market to buy a guitar, Rainbow was the store. You go in there, they had Jackson's, US and Japanese ones. They had Fenders and Gibsons and Music Man. They had all the legit stuff. They were a legit store. They had Marshalls. And so I remember I decided to buy a Marshall and I had the cash. And I was 18. That's how old I was. I was 18 years old and I went to Rainbow. I'll never forget this story because it's really what changed me as a person. It's one of those like life-defining moments of how you should learn to treat people. I went into Rainbow Guitars. I remember this on a Sunday with cash and a wad because I was 18. I was dumb. So I put a wad of cash in my pocket to go buy a Marshall head and cabinet. I was going to finally arrive, as sometimes it's said, and buy a Marshall. I went into Rainbow Guitars. No one would help me. So I finally found a guy and I said, hey, I want to buy. I didn't even say I want to try it. I was so dumb. I didn't even know what a Marshall sounded like, really. But I was like, I want to buy that Marshall. And he's like, oh, yeah, we can't let you try it. You know, you got to unless you buy it. I go, I'd like to buy it. And he's like, oh, you can't buy it unless you make an appointment on Monday. I'm like, what? I'm like, because they were closed Mondays for appointment. He's like, yeah, because we need you to try it before you buy it. And we don't want you to play it because it's loud until, you know, and so you have to make an appointment on Monday. And I'm like, now I lived far from Rainbow. It was on the other side of town. I was like, okay, well, I need to make an appointment for tomorrow because I need to buy it. And he's like, oh, we're all booked up. So I left, and this is a true story. It's depressing. And I went back to my side of town. I bought a Krait Stealth head and cabinet for the same amount of money as a Marshall cabinet, because the store that sold me the Krait Stealth was full retail. And now maybe it's a little bit less, but it was about the same. So I bought a Krait 100 watt tube Stealth, which is a great amp. And I think actually to be accurate, I bought two 412s, because I did. Two Krait 412s and the head were the same price as the Marshall head and cabinet. Of course, what a horrible decision that was, because as much as I like that amp, in the long term, the Marshall was a better investment and better product to have from the Krait. But what a douchey store. So, you know, and the other thing is, that's funny is I never went in that store again. That's not a correct statement. It's not that I never went in that store again. When I had my store, believe it or not, I decided I wanted, I think, some pedal. I forgot what it was. And I didn't want to carry the line in my store. My store had been around for about 6 years at the time. So in Arizona at that time, you know, my store was definitely, if you think of the three largest stores for volume of vendors for Fender and stuff, we were there. So I remember reaching out to Rainbow and saying, hey, I'm a dealer up in Phoenix. And I want this pedal, and I'd like to buy it from you. And I knew what cost was, and I said, hey, could you give me 10% off? I have a resale license. You know, can we do that? And they basically said no. And I remember laughing, going, you know, I probably should pursue that, but they just weren't a friendly store. So I heard they're much better now. So I'd love to hear it if they're better now. Maybe when next time in Tucson, I just never go in there when I go to Tucson because they were always, they're that older store mentality of the don't touch stuff and we're too cool for you. And that was not the vibe I liked as a, you know, that's not the vibe I like, man. Okay, what else do we got? It's a nice little fun little moment. Let's see. Gonzo Pew Pew says, Phil, when playing loud, I get a microphonic ring from my power tubes, but it passes the chopstick test. Thoughts? That's tough, Gonzo, man. Well, the chopstick test is really just going to tell you if not only is the tube microphonic, but if the tube is bad. When you're saying playing loud, that's different because the tube, it's different when you're working the tube harder. So what I'm basically saying is the issue could be so minute that that's the only time it comes into play. But my guess is if you're getting a microphonic ring. Also, keep in mind, it might not be the power tubes. It might be a preamp tube. So definitely not just check the, so if chopsticks test your power tubes, then I would now go ahead and say, check the preamp tubes. I like personally to have about a dozen preamp tubes laying around. I keep them in boxes and stuff. Just because if you have a tube head, you know, you never know when you're swapping out. Don't be afraid to swap out some of the preamp tubes and see if you can fix the issue. And you're not saying what kind of amp it is, and keep, and so there's something I want to tell you. The 12AT7s from Groove Tubes, what I've noticed is they're constantly a problem. So if you have a 12AT7, so if you have an amp that has like a reverb or a tremolo in it, and it has, I mean, and it's got a 12AT7, 9 times out of 10, that thing's crap. And I'd almost say 10 times out of 10, I just do not like that tube. In fact, I did a video on like how to fix your Hot Rod Deluxe, or how to make it quieter using a 12AT7. And I forgot in that video, it's one of the regrets I have on YouTube. I forgot to mention not to use the Groove Tube one. If you look in the comments on that, half the comments are like, I used it, Phil, it was great, thank you. Or, hey, Phil, I used it, now it's ringing. And it's because, and every time you see me comment in there, I go, did you buy the Groove Tube? Yes. Don't do that. Get the JJ or another brand. So something to think about. It could also not be your power tubes. You could have a preamp tube issue as well. So try that. And then once you've successfully done that, which is very inexpensive, then it's time to look at the power tubes and think about the fact that they could just be bad tubes, but not bad enough to come through by tapping on them. And then some of the amp gurus that watch the channel, hang on the channel, that are smarter than me, they might put some comments too that help you out. So look for those as well, because that's one thing I noticed. You guys are awesome. Some of you guys are putting I'm just reading comments now too. Sorry. So we sometimes, a lot of times, if you guys ask questions on this channel, I can't pin them because you only get to pin one question on the video. So I can't pin all the questions, but so you know, I try to like, I put the little heart next to it and put a thumbs up. And so you guys know that's either I read it, but a lot of times it's to highlight that person, what they're saying. I'm like, yeah, good, you know, good comment or good answer. So some of the people I wished, you know, that's one thing I think that makes the live show great. A lot of people are getting their questions answered. It's not even by me. It's just open sourced, in other words, what's great. But I try, because I know that if you get 3 questions on the internet, 2 are probably people who shouldn't be answering it, and 1 has the right answer. How do you know? I try to at least, you know, qualify that by, you know, putting something next to them. Let's see. What else? Gunky Zip. Thanks, man. Did a top chat for no reason. Oh, cheers for the Red Maple Jackson in the video. Thanks. Wasn't that fun? That's the video, man, that I see, I'm lighting up. That's the video I always get so excited about, because it wasn't like I bought the guitar for the video. It wasn't like the video. In fact, I had no idea I was going to even make a video. I cheated on that one. It was great. I bought the guitar. It happened. It was with Ralph. It was last Saturday. And then I posted a picture on Instagram and said, hey, if you think I should do a video. And I got like 1,000 likes on it, really, which I never really get on a picture. I get a lot of likes when I make a video on Instagram, but not a picture. And I got so many likes, I go, oh, well, I got to do a video. And so I did the video, and it was great. And it really felt good, because a lot of the comments on the video really kind of affirm what I already think, which is, I really enjoy doing the videos where it's like a little bit of information and less of a review kind of vibe. I've never really liked the whole review vibe. I've always tried to be like a, here's a, like a Know Your Gear thing. Like, here's one thing you didn't know kind of thing. And that really helped. And especially since in that video, like my 5 things videos, in that video, that was, that information came from a conversation I had with the person I'm talking about. So when I talk about that in the video, that's not something I read or heard about. It's physically, I was at lunch one day talking to John Romanowski, and he told me, you know, why he's deciding to do these things. And then later, you know, like almost 10 years later, I'm like, oh yeah, this is why he's doing it. Cause I remember this, you know, him talking about it. Oh my gosh. Merlin. I don't know if I'm saying it probably, says, do you sharpen anyone's axes? I have 2 Sharp My Axe videos done that are not somebody else's axes. They're more of instructional type videos. One will be a giveaway, and 1 is, you know, not, cause it's my guitar. I'm doing something crazy to one of my guitars. I'm not saying I've given up on the Sharpen My Axe thing. I'm still going to do Sharpen My Axe. The issue really was, I've had 12 companies, and that's probably an understatement, reach out and say, we want to support Sharpen My Axe. Here's some parts. The problem is, like, yeah, that's all the parts I need, But the expense of Sharp Max is always going to be the shipping, the time, you know what I mean? And mostly it's the shipping and the time. It's really the time that kills you, because the average Sharp Max video takes me about 3 days to do and then edit, because it's the editing that kills you. It's a lot of editing. So yes, I'm going to do them, but I backed off for a little while. But also keep in mind, I back off. If you notice on the repair videos, we talked about this a couple weeks ago, if you watch the show, in the summertime, you'll notice a lot less repair videos because of what I talked about. I can't run the air or a fan in the shop, because and it's so hot that I actually did. So, you know, I started the Sharp in my X video a couple days ago. And I did something dumb. I bought a thermostat. I'm laughing because this is how bad it was. I got it down. I got it cooled down to 78 degrees. I was like, awesome. I started working in the shop, and within 20 minutes, it said it was 92, and I was dying. I was like, oh, it's just hot. It got so, because it was 114 outside. I mean, I think at that time it was 112, and it was just cooking up that place too fast. So yeah, it's just too hot. So soon, more. And I have a new little shop area that I probably shouldn't have said that out loud, but you'll see. So that is cooled. And more importantly, quiet. Because it's not about the coolness. It's about the stupid quiet. It's hard to do videos if it's not. Like, this room is really soundproof. You can't hear any echo in here. Because it's small and it's drapes. Like, if anyone's ever curious what's in this room, anyone who ever comes over, they always go, it's not what I expected. And I'm like, yeah, it's Glenn Fricker's got the same thing. If you ever watch Glenn Fricker and stuff, there's tons of YouTubers. If you ever go see, the rooms that they're in are small. This room is small. And what I'm looking at mostly is a window, pedals, of course, wall pedals, and then lots of drapes. It's just lots of drapes, because that's why it's dead in here. There's no echo in here at all. Okay, so this is fun. How are we doing on time? We're almost at the end right now. So let's make sure I don't miss any super chats. Okay, hold on a second. We got James. James, what's up, James? He says, thoughts on online music programs like Berklee University. Have you ever taught bass or guitar lessons online? I've never taught guitar or bass online. I have taught bass, some guitar, but mostly bass in person. I've done that for years, actually. Many years, actually. So I don't know. I've never taught it online. What's my thought on those programs? I think they work. I think they're effective. I like to use this rule of thought when it comes to learning, okay? I think this is a more practical way of thinking about the value of education when it comes to learning music. I'm going to say you can learn from, let's start with an easy thing. You can learn from a book. It's not as good as probably a video, because most people are going to be learn better with the video instruction with the, obviously the sheet music, right? So I think a book, but I think better than a book is maybe a video, right? What's better than a video is probably some kind of interactive video. In other words, some kind of computer program or live Skype video interaction. Then after that, you have classrooms, right? So classrooms are great because, again, you can ask teachers questions, but they're probably not as good as, let's say, the one-on-one lesson, right? So, and some of you guys are going to disagree with that, but it's not about, you can sort that however you want, but I don't like the attitude of like, this is a horrible way to learn, this is a good way. It's really it's about just like guitars. It's just like $100 guitars to $10,000 guitars. It's not good or bad. It's, you have a budget. What can you fit into your budget, and then be realistic about what you're getting for your budget. So some people are like, man, I cannot play $1,200 a year for one-on-one lessons, because it's about $100 a month minimum, and $1,200 a year, that's too much. Right. Well, you can get an online course for $200. And is it as good? I don't think so. But it's also $1,000 cheaper. So you know what I mean? And when I say as good, I mean effective and speed. It's not about whether or not you learn. I think if you want to learn, you'll learn no matter what. There's probably a dozen of you typing right now that I can't see about how you just taught yourself. You could totally teach yourself. Absolutely. When somebody used to tell me, like, my kid, he just learned by ear. He didn't need any instruction. I go, of course. It just took him longer. If somebody says, oh, my kid's he's a masterful guitar player, learned in 2 years how to play by ear. And I go, right. And if he had lessons, he would have done it in half the time. That's what I think. It's not proof. It's just, that's what I think. I think that it would have helped. So, So my point is I think a lot of the way you learn isn't whether it's effective or not. It's how fast or how effective is it. So online programs work great. They're not as good as the real deal, but in my opinion, but they're not bad. I do both. I think it's fun. And online is so convenient that it actually has benefits to not doing online. That being said, I have a couple of friends who have degrees from the Berkeley University online university, and they enjoyed it. So they enjoyed it, and they're smarter than me, definitely in music theory. So I don't know if that's because of that. Maybe they were already smart and they decided to go to do that, or maybe they learned it. But either way, they're definitely got more music theory power than I have. Hold on. Now that comment, I want to see if there's any. Shaman Blues, there is something about having an appointment that makes you do the practice you need to do. Absolutely. I go to lessons every Wednesday. Scratch my ear, sorry. For that exact reason. I go to lessons and I hate the idea that my guitar teacher, talk about horrible this is. My guitar teacher, Matt, might be watching this video, and I hope he isn't, because he's supposed to be on vacation this week. But hopefully he isn't. You know what I love when I say off the record, which is on YouTube, so it's dumb to say this. What I love about my Wednesday lesson, I practice Tuesday night. It's just, you got to be honest, man. You got to tell the truth. So here's the deal. That's what I love about my weekly lesson. You're absolutely right, Showman Blues, is that it's not that I go every Wednesday to my lesson. It's that every Tuesday night I practice for sure. I don't mean I practice, because I practice every day. I play every day. But every Tuesday night I practice what I'm supposed to do on Wednesday. That is what Wednesday lessons give me, is that drive to desire. In my world, it's different. Everybody has a different reasoning. In my world, it's about making sure I don't show up to on Wednesday's lesson with the disrespect of not practicing. You know, like, what did we do last week? Oh, I'm still working on it, right? Like, I literally want to show him I cared and I practiced, because I respect what he does. He's a great teacher. And so that's what I do. And if I have to stay up all night on Tuesday to do it, I do it. Although I do practice a little bit during the week too. I don't want to kind of shum off that I'm not. But I will say the bulk of what I'm trying to work out is I'm a crammer. Last minute crammer sometimes. Let's see. Neil A says, hey, Phil, your thoughts on reissue guitars? Are they usually identical to the year they claim to be? Electronics, etc. And do you think the higher price is money well spent? Thanks you for your great channel. Thank you, Neil. My official thoughts on that, or my thoughts on the reissue guitars, is that I like reissue guitars. So first, let's start with that. I think they're cool. I like the idea of bringing old things back sometimes is really cool. Some people are like, it's not very imaginative. But sometimes it's cool. Do I think they're identical? No, because logic dictates that they're probably not. And the reason why I say that is, if you look at it, I constantly see companies do revisions to reissue guitars. And what you learn is that a lot of guitar companies, when you go and visit them, they don't even really know. So you, in your head, you kind of picture, I think this is one thing that I definitely pictured a long time ago that ended up never being true, which is, I picture when you go to Fender or when you go to Gibson, they have all the guitars in an archive, you know, all the ones they ever met, you know, made. And if they want to know, the reality is a lot of those companies, they don't have a lot of the stuff. So when they go, you know, for instance, now I'm just giving this as an analogy, because I don't want to say something and then Fender put in the comments, no, it's not true, Phil. But I would imagine right now that if Fender decided to reissue the Strat Pluses from the early 90s, they'd have to go buy some. They probably don't have any. I mean, sure, an employee could have one and stuff, but I'm talking about Fender, like in an archive. They don't have them. So, and they don't have it, that predates what you think about, like, oh, they have the specs. Well, why would they have the specifications? This the machines that built the Strat Plus in 1990, they don't exist in the Fender facility for the most part. You know what I mean? They have newer machines and stuff. So, so what you find is a lot of companies, believe it or not, when they reissue stuff, they have to go buy it. And then when they buy it, it's a sample, because not all those guitars and not all those things that they buy are the same. So they have to get a sampling of them. So you hear it a lot. So and I think that's cool and I think it's great. But what you notice is sometimes they learn over time. Fender's definitely, I use Fender because Fender's a good example. They've definitely reissued vintage guitars, and somebody's like, again? And I'm like, I don't think you're paying attention. It's not like they're reissuing again. They're literally telling you, they had it wrong a little bit in the last version, and they've perfected it. a couple years ago, I want to say like 2014, Fender reissued a lot of the 50s, 60s Strats again. I forgot what they did. But I remember one of the things that was funny was they realized that the mold they were using for the knobs was wrong, and they changed that. Seems minute and silly, but if you're trying to reissue something, isn't the point to make it exact or close to it, you know? Yeah, and Cowtown Customs. Hey, Cowtown. Cowtown Customs says you can make a great guitar, but not make old wood. Well, of course. Well, first of all, let's talk about that on the reissues. Yes, you can't recreate some of the magic. Physically can't do it because the way that they do stuff is different. Sometimes the components they can't get those original components in there. Wood is different. But also, age does things. I mean, age changes pickup tone. Age breaks in the feel. I mean, it's just, you know. There you go. I agree with Cowtown Customs. You can't recreate it. That, like I said, but let's see. What else do we got? We have, how are we doing? Okay, we're doing good. William Spruce says, Phil, this is just because I love your channel and you look thinner. Yeah, I was down and then I came up a little bit. And you know what did it? Was Nashville. I put on like 5 pounds in Nashville. Southern food, man, is the best, but there is no way around that. By the way, Nashville, I know you have a trendy side now and stuff, but literally, dude, I mean, there's no way to enjoy yourself in Nashville and not eat barbecue food in Southern. But yes, thank you. And he goes, so there's more to the question, by the way. What's your favorite online lesson, Marty, Justin, or Fender Tricks? At this point, I'd be biased, man. I met Marty. I did a video with Marty. I'm going to be doing some more videos with Marty, and he is so nice. I've never met Justin. He looks nice, you know, right? Justin looks like how I perceived Marty to be online, but I've never met Justin. Meeting Marty was a really impressive thing, not just because he's a big channel, but just because he was, like, so nice. You know what I mean? You meet somebody, and just enjoyed our conversation and everything. And so obviously I like him. So if you're asking for suggestion, I'm going to suggest him just because I like him. And I know he knows what he's talking about. Although the other two are cool. Fender Tricks, I'm not sure. I've never tried it. Fender, the only thing I can tell you is, again, it's not to take an opportunity to slam Fender because I'm a Fender guy. How about that? I like Fender. But probably just because it needs to be aired as many times as possible, because it's one of the things that I thought Fender did really wrong. Fender reached out to me, just like a lot of YouTubers, about promoting their Fender lessons, and I responded to them with, I thought, which is a simple request. They said, hey, if I promote Fender lessons with you, the viewers, they'll give me a kickback or a fee every time somebody clicks it. If you notice, I've never done it. It's because all I asked in return was like, that's great. The money thing. Sure. Great. Okay, great. I suggest it. They click. I get a kickback that funds the channel. Sure, I'll tell the audience that there's a kickback and it will be all fine. My only problem is I don't know anything about your lesson program. Can you send me a link so I can check it out? No links, nothing. They didn't seem interested, to be honest with you. And that's not Fender, that's the person I was dealing with. So I was very clear, but I cannot recommend something I have no idea what it is. So there you go. And anyone who suggests, like, well, maybe you could have just got one of the lessons and then suggested it. The kickbacks you get on those things, I mean, we're talking about over a year, I'd probably make about $10 to $15. So, I mean, it didn't even pay for doing the lessons. I mean, it's not a lot of kickbacks. You get like 1%. I don't know. It doesn't matter. That's not the issue. The issue is I can't recommend something I've never checked out. I thought it was an easy request. Just let me check it out, and then I'll tell you if it's something I recommend. So Fender, again, not that Fender would ever watch this, but hey, Fender, if you ever want to send me a link to check out your stuff, if I like it, I promise I'll do it. It's not even about the fee. If there's no fee, that's fine too. Just like this. People are curious. I'd love to have an answer. Besides, I don't know. Riff Magos said, thanks, Phil. You're always keeping it real. Really appreciate that after I just did the real speech. That is perfectly timed. Perfectly timed. I did that. Actually, I knew that question was coming. No, I'm just kidding. Thank you, Riff. I appreciate that. Well, it's because it's not about that. It's about I want to have a relationship with everyone that I'm talking to. That's all this is about, man. You guys can sniff out when everybody's full of crap. I think I've told you guys this before. I've only tried it once, and it was so long. It was 2 years ago. I did a video of a product. I don't remember the product. It's gone. The video is gone. It didn't last up more than 2 hours. I'll never forget this. And some of you guys that are old viewers are going to probably rat me out. But that's fine. I did a product review. It was early on, right, on my career of YouTubing, if you could call it a career, whatever. I did a product that I did not like. It was the only time I've ever done it. Like, when you guys hear me critique a product, it's not because I don't like it. It's actually because I like it and I'm upset that it's not, you know, you're like, I want it to be better, or I want it to fulfill my needs or fit my expectations. But I've only done one video of a product where I just didn't like it. I didn't get it. I didn't understand what it was about, what its value was. And what's funny was, I'll never forget this, I put the video up, you know, and I did my thing. I was like, hey, this is a, you know, this is the product and let's go through it. And of course, in the video, I don't really say anything. I don't say that it's good. I don't say it's bad. I just figured, okay. Early on in the YouTube, I was thinking, well, does everything have to be what I love? Because it's very limited. You know what I mean? Am I only going to talk about stuff I like? That's a very narrow window of what I'm going to be able to show people. So I said, okay, this product, I don't like it, but I don't have to like it. I just have to show it. So I showed it. I don't know how many minutes or comments it was before it happened, but somebody put, this is all. Talk about the greatest troll comment in the history of my trolling comments, because it wasn't a hateful comment. It was just perfectly timed and put. Here was the comment. Man, I'd love to play poker with Phil McKnight. And it was funny because I was like, man. It was like, yep, you could just tell. You just could sense that I wasn't digging it. So I took the video down because it wasn't fair to the company. So those of you guys old school, remember I took the video down, whatever. It was, and this is the, like old time. Like we're not talking about thousands of views. It probably only got about 800 views total. Maybe close to 1,000, which was good at that time, but so it was fun. And I learned something. And what I learned was, if I really don't like something, we could talk about it, but I shouldn't do a video on it. Cause it's just, cause if I don't like it, it really doesn't matter. It just, if I just, you know, you get the idea. And I don't mean, you get what I'm saying. Somebody's laughing. I'm glad you're laughing. It was funny. Like I said, it really learned. By the way, this is true also. And then I'm going to end on this note. I have not played poker since that video. I've been afraid to. I'm not kidding. I wish that was an exaggeration for the joke. I just literally will not do it. I was just like, oh, because I thought I did a great job. I was really like, this, okay, let's look at the next thing. And then this thing. And I was just talking about it. And man, it just, I go, okay, if I'm natty. Somebody goes, was it Lightning Boy Pedals? No, Lightning Boy Pedals was exactly, B-Search, so you guys remember, Lightning Boy Pedals was exactly what I'm talking about. From that video, not the Lightning Boy Pedal, but that video, I learned, do not review something you do not like. You know, by the way, that has nothing, you know, some people have different opinions about this, but I learned that because not only that episode and that happened, but like comedians say, don't make fun of somebody you don't like or you can't appreciate. Because instead of funny, it feels hateful. That's what I learned. Like if I go, hey, like I said, let me give you an example. If I said, you know, let's say I buy a guitar and I like the guitar and I like the company, but I'm really unhappy with the fact that they made these three decisions, right? Well, I'll share that unhappiness with you. You know what I mean? I just did that with the More pedal. I just reviewed the More Tone pedal. You know what? I like More. You know what? I like their products. I've reviewed a couple of their products. They're good. That product, it was okay. It wasn't bad. And I put the review out because of that reason. I think anybody who wants it, I think there's a reason to buy it. I didn't fawn over it because I didn't have anything to fawn over. But I liked it as a whole and I liked where it was going. So there you go. So on that note, that's what I did. So Lightning Boy Audio was exactly that. He got mad because I didn't review it. I didn't review it because I didn't like it. That's what I thought. And no one would have known with that. That's how that would have ended forever. So, you know, not to rehash old things, but it's just funny that you brought that up because that should have ended with, he sent it to me. I didn't like it. He wanted it back. I sent it back. He was unhappy with how he sent it back. I offered, by the way, immediately to buy it. That should have been the end of it. But instead of letting me, why would I buy it? I didn't want it. I just did it because I was like, oh, all right. If he's unhappy with the way I shipped it back to him, I'll just pay for it. But instead of letting it lie, he got upset. He was upset because I didn't review it. Even though I tried to explain, I didn't review it because I don't like it. So there you go. All right. So there's my whole thing. All right. On that note, we're going to call it. We ended at 4 o'clock. So same time we opened early. For those of you guys that didn't know, I started the show early today because not right now, but, after this index goes up on this video, you guys look forward tonight. There'll be a video about a unboxing of that world record, Sweetwater pedal that they sent out. They're sending out the pedals to, I would imagine, 30 people, because there's 30 something boards, and they sent them out. Except for not everyone, because here's what's cool, and this is what you guys know, you can win a couple of the boards. It's really cool. I actually watched, I watched the Rob Scallon video, and I watched all the videos about it. It was really interesting. Not because I care about how the biggest world record pedal board was. That wasn't really something I was interested in. I was just interested in the craziness of putting 319 pedals together and how they did it and how well it came out and how bad it came out and what they have to do to deal with it. So there you go. All right, guys, on that note, 6 second hum just got here. That's all right, we'll hang out in a week. On that note, I'm gonna let you guys go, and then before I go, I want to do a shout out to the patrons that make this happen, because they support this live show every week, and that's a big deal for all of us, I hope, because if you're hanging out, I hope you like it. And let me go ahead and read off that list. It's James Biles, Lawrence Petros, Rob Martha, David Foy, Blake Bean, Derek Miller, Glenn Graham, Michael Mooney, Alasdair MacLeod, Bruce Garris. By the way, Alasdair MacLeod is the featured pitcher of the week. He took a Know Your Gear pitcher with Steve I, Joe Satriani, Dave Wiener, Larry Mitchell. I mean, it's just like, it's crazy. David Townsend, so great pitcher. Michael Mooney, Bruce Collins, Andy Dennis, Gary Phillips, Sam Oram, Chief Squatch, Muse Guitarist, Bob Crosley, Todd Flowers, Zesty Basil Pizza, Greg Peterson, Dennis Prescott, Craig Parker, Lonnie Hoke, Joseph McCarthy, Anthony Desposito, Brian Stewart, Kermit Jackson, Tim Camacho, Paul Osterreich, Michael Lindner, Jonathan Pickering, Bob Pickwode, Lewis and Alvaro, Chris at the Guitar Pit, Jeff Howes, BV Ninja, Zachary Rowe, Justin Mabe, and Jeff Thompson literally make this show happen every week, this live hangout and these QAs, plus the whole channel happen, and plus more patrons, and I appreciate everybody who does that, support the patron. Without you guys, I would have never continued on this channel like I've done, and I thank you guys for that. And until next time, I'll just leave you with a Know Your Gear. Is that the thing I say? That's the thing I say. All right, guys.